Chapter 4, Financial Markets. In Chapter 3, we considered investment to be exogenous. It was considered fixed or given. In fact, investment depends on interest rates. Monetary policy influences those interest rates. This chapter shows you how interest rates are determined in the financial markets through the interaction of demand for money and the supply of money. This chapter considers nominal income or nominal GDP as given, which affects money demand, so we can isolate working of financial markets. Chapter 5 studies determination of output and interest rates in the short run together. Price level is considered fixed as before, so real income is also fixed. Another simplification is that we are assuming financial markets consist of only two assets, money and bonds. Equilibrium in the money market is thus equal to equilibrium in the bonds market. Learning objectives. Understand how interest rate is determined by the demand and supply of money. Understand how monetary policy can influence the interest rate. Equation 4.1 shows the demand for money is equal to nominal income times a function of the interest rate. The demand for money increases in proportion to nominal income. It depends negatively on the interest rate on bonds. Families must decide how to allocate their financial wealth, say $100,000 from past savings, which is given at a point of time between money and bonds. Money which includes currency, coins and notes, and checkable deposits pays no interest. Money is needed for transactions. Higher level of transactions represented by nominal income would lead to higher money demand. If nominal income increases by 10%, money demand will increase by 10%. Reasonable to assume level of transactions is proportional to nominal income. Demand for money is negatively related to interest rate because higher interest rate would lead people to holding more bonds and less money and vice versa. Interest rate is what people can earn on short-term bonds in money market funds. Figure 4.1 shows the money demand curve. It is drawn for a given level of nominal income. It is negatively sloping, showing the inverse relationship between the interest rate and the demand for money. Interest rate is shown on the vertical axis and money demand on the horizontal axis. As interest rate decreases, the demand for money increases. At a given interest rate, increase in nominal income shifts the money demand curve to the right. Equation 4.2 shows money supply is equal to money demand. This gives us the LM relation. We will try to understand what money supply depends on. To simplify, assume the only kind of money is currency in circulation, which is supplied by the central banks. Equilibrium in financial markets requires that money supply be equal to money demand. The equation for financial market equilibrium means that the interest rate should be such that given nominal income, people must be willing to hold an amount of money equal to the existing money supply. In Figure 4.2, money supply curve is vertical, showing it does not depend on the interest rate. Money demand curve is a negative function of the interest rate. Equilibrium occurs at point A, where the money supply and money demand curves intersect, and the equilibrium interest rate is given by I. Figure 4.3 shows increase in nominal income, which is the same as nominal GDP, shifts the money demand curve to the right. This leads to an increase in the equilibrium interest rate. Understand the process by which the economy will get to the new equilibrium level. At the original equilibrium rate, shift of the money demand curve will increase the demand for money. Since people want more cash, they will sell bonds to convert that money to cash. As demand for bonds falls, their price will fall and the interest rate will rise. This increase in interest rate will cause people to reduce their demand for money till it is equal to the money supply available. Figure 4.4 shows increase in money supply shifts money supply curve to the right. Increase in money supply thus leads to a fall in the equilibrium interest rate. At the original interest rate, money supply exceeds money demand and thus interest rates need to fall in order for people to be willing to hold more money till it equals money supply. Note, interest rates on bonds and their prices vary inversely. The price of bonds is determined in the bond market. Interest rates are then inferred from that. A bond which is worth $100 in 1 year will yield an interest rate depending on the price which it sells for, represented by PB. I equals $100 minus PB divided by PB. Figure 4.5 shows conduct of monetary policy using open market operations. Central banks change money supply by buying and selling bonds for money in the open market for bonds. To expand money supply, the Fed buys bonds and pays for them by issuing money. This increases currency in circulation and hence money supply. Both the bank's assets and liabilities increase by the same amount. We now extend our model to see how monetary policy works when money includes not only currency, but checkable deposits too. Central banks control currency, but not checkable deposits. Checkable deposits are held by commercial banks or private banks. Figure 4.6 shows the asset side of the central bank is the same as before. On the liability side, you see that some of the money issued by central banks is now held by private banks as reserves, along with currency that is being held by the public. Central bank can directly influence the sum of currency and reserves. Figure 4.8 shows an alternative way of understanding the determination of interest rate. Interest rate is determined by the demand and supply of central bank money. Central bank money is called high-powered money. This is also called the monetary base. Money supply is a multiple of the monetary base. Money multiplier is equal to money supply divided by monetary base. So essentially, the central bank controls the money supply by controlling the monetary base. Money multiplier in a checkable deposits only economy is 1 over the required reserve ratio.